Jean-Michel Kejofer from Toulouse University. So he's the LAMET chair in this semester. So, and he will speak on the propagation of reaction diffusion fronts driven by a line of fast diffusion.
Thanks very much for the invitation. So a practical question, where should I stand? In any case, what's interesting is the screen, not my face, so that's, let me stand here. So thank you very much to everyone. So indeed, I'm going to tell you about reaction diffusion fronts driven by lines of fast diffusion. So here are the people I've worked with in this talk. So Henri Birastiki from HESS, Luis Caffarelli from Austin, and Charline Coulon is a former PhD student of mine, and Luca Rossi is at the moment in Rome. So here's the motivation. So it has indeed long been known that transportation networks can enhance very much biological invasions. So biological invasion, it's not always something hostile, it's just an animal or a vegetal, or a bacteria, or a bacterium, or a tree that occupies an environment. The only thing is that what I'm going to talk about is rather hostile things, like tiger mosquitoes or processionary moths. These animals can pose a significant health issues, and both have colonized Europe northwards faster than anticipated, and in fact they are believed to have used the road system in Europe. Another not so nice biological invasion is an epidemic. It has also known for a long time that epidemics can travel along roads. They can literally travel along roads. One of the first instances that was documented, but not the first, as a matter of fact, there were examples in the Roman times, is the 1347 Black Plague. So it very efficiently removed something like 1/3 of the European population. And it's known to have followed the trade fair roads from the south of Europe to northern Europe. And it's also known to have spread inland. And of course, it's not so easy not to talk about the current episode. Here, of course, there are much more precise data than in these years. And for instance, if you look at the maps of northern Italy, it is absolutely striking to see how this epidemic was able to follow the roads. Let me tell you about one specific example, because it's my area. It's the area I live in. And it is related to the spread of the yellow-legged hornet in the southwest of France. So here's a yellow-legged hornet. I don't know if it exists in Russia. It's a beautiful insect, something like 2 to 3 centimeters long. It's not the nice. Okay, entomologists claim that it's shy and peaceful. The only problem is that the insect doesn't always know that it is shy and peaceful, and as a matter of fact, there have been several accidents with it. It was probably introduced around 2004. I'm going to show you the map, the next slide, coming from China in a boat transporting bonsai pots, and then it thrived very it's thrived very well. So here's, let me show you the story. So, okay, maybe I'm going to use this. This is a map of France. This is a map of France. So the green squares, it comes from the Muséum d'Histoire Naturelle. It's a very, very serious institution there. The green squares are clickable squares. Well, you can click on them, but they represent the dates where the insect was first seen. So now let us look at the map. So in fact, there's a big river in France. Where is it? It's the Garonne. Starts from here. starts from here, goes down from Bordeaux to Toulouse. I'm from Toulouse. It does something like that. And what is very striking is that the first dates are around Bordeaux. Then, if you click along the Garonne River, they are really early dates. And then the insect spreads orthogonal to the river. That's absolutely fascinating. As a matter of fact, one of my students pointed out the following very interesting fact. If now you look at the Loire, of course, the French rivers are not the scale of the Russian rivers, but still, the Loire is a pretty decent river, something like 1,000 kilometers, starts in Saint-Nazaire and goes through Nantes. And you see, there are already appearances of the insect along the Loire. And I can bet that now the whole place is colonized by the insect. And so here the means of transportation is the river. Give some substance to what I'm saying. I mean, quite unexpected biological invasions can be driven by transportation networks, or in this particular case, maybe it was just water. But in any case, it was a very useful device to. For the insect. So the objectives are the following. So first of all, I would like to, of course, it seems to be such a generic phenomenon that you want to try to see if you can write equation for this so that you can A, predict what you see, and B, confirm what you see, and B, predict other features. So what we want to do is to construct a stylized mathematical model on which we can see the effects. I want to analyze the mathematical models. They can be sometimes non-trivial. Compare their conclusions to data. And of course, here the mathematical analysis. Well, I expected to give some results that are going to be relevant for biological observations. But then usually the model I'm going to show you is non-standard. And it's interesting to go further in the study, even if the biological interest is not at its peak. So here's the outline. So first of all, I would like to say a few words about Fisher KPP. Front propagation in the Fisher KPP equation. Then I will explain how one can include a line of fast diffusion rather easily. I will tell you about general results, and finally some further mathematical results. Okay, so let's go. So first of all, let me say about a few things about. The Fisher KPP equation. So what we are modeling is a population that evolves with time. It has a density. You can describe the population by the density, essentially the number of individuals per unit surface. And we just assume that the individuals move and reproduce. We introduce a small density of individuals somewhere, and we want to see what happens. So the question is, first of all, can we write down an equation for you just with these assumptions? And second, what is the large time behavior of the solution of the equation that we have written? Okay, so let me tell you, I mean, one slide about the equation. So here, I means u. So I'm just saying that the variation of u is the caused by reproduction, entries, and minus exits. So the entries, we say that we take a small disk. We say that the entries are proportional to the average of the density on the small disk, and the exits are proportional to minus the average of the density around the small disk. So this is something we declare. This is something that we declare, why not? And then we declare the proportional to be like d over r squared. And so if the movements are very small, then entries minus exits are essentially the limit when r goes to 0 of d over r square of the integral on the small disk of u of t y minus u of t x dy, d over r square times the average over the square disk of u of t y minus u of t x. And when you take the limit, of d over r square of the average of the difference, you see the Laplacian. Of course, one could make other choices because there are many things we are declaring. And what I'm claiming is that they are not the most stupid things to declare, but we could also say that R is finite. I mean, the radius of the small disk is finite. Good. And this, this gives us another kind of diffusion, and we can also have more complicated diffusions if we want. This is not going to be useful to us. Reproduction, where I'm going to take the oldest modeling possible. So if the population is homogeneous, so the PD becomes an ODE, so it's just the variation of the density everywhere. We first say that it has to grow by some mechanism, but also there is a saturation mechanism that prevents the population from being too large, and so the simplest thing to do it is to say okay, it's proportional to the density, and also proportional to some factor, some limiting factor, 1 minus u over beta, and beta is it's called the carrying capacity. It's the maximal quantity that the population, I mean the maximum density of the population, that allows it to strive. And when u is below beta, then u starts going down. This gives rise to the Fisher KPP equation. So ut minus Laplace u is equal to alpha u 1 minus u over beta. It appeared, Fisher was probably the first to introduce to the model. Then of course, Kolmogorov. The two P's are for Petrovsky and Piskunov, and these three gentlemen have made probably the first rigorous work on this equation. Let me tell you the result that I'm going to discuss. So. It's called what I called the spreading at for large times. So you solve the equation and put a small density of individuals somewhere. And when you analyze the equation, you have the following result. So let's call CKPP equals 2 square root of d alpha. So it's a number. And so it's a result. So it's a general result by Aronson and Weinberger. It was already in the Kolmogorov-Petrovsky-Piskunov paper in one space dimension. It says the following. So take a disk of radius CKPPT, or a radius of a disk of radius 2 square root of d alpha times t. Then we say that if C is less than CKPP, then U of TS goes to 1 if X is less than CT. So as a matter of fact, I have just made one approximation when I say that that DTU is equal to D Laplace U plus alpha U 1 minus U over beta, then I have here said beta is equal to 1. I have normalized things to 1. And if C is larger than CKPP, then U of Tx goes to 0 if X is larger than CT. So what does it mean? If you run a little less fast than CKPP, well, essentially, all around you, you see your population of animals. So if the population is yellow egg hornets, you are surrounded by yellow egg hornet if you don't run fast enough. And if you run very fast, then you essentially see nothing around you. So this is what is called spreading at speed CKPP. If you run a little bit less fast, then you see the population at its maximal carrying capacity. And if you run faster, your population is essentially equal to zero. Okay, so that's the basic result. I mean, it's a very old, very honorable result. Now let us see what we can do if we include the line of fast diffusion. So this is what we called, with my co-authors, the road field model, because there's a road and there's a field, and we are going to discuss that. So we consider a large population. I mean, when I say large, a dense population in a half plane that I'm calling the field. So it's something like that. So that's KPP, and let's say broad field. So here's we take let's say the lower half plane. That's the field, delimited by a line that I call the road. Okay, and so the individual move and reproduce in the field, and they travel on the line. When I say travel, they can travel very fast. And the line and the field exchange individuals at some constant rate. So once again, at t equals zero, a small density is introduced in the field. The questions are, what are the equations? I mean, what equations can you write? And what is the large time spreading on the road and on the field? So here, this is what I just started writing. So we take R2 minus, so this is the field. The line is the x-axis. I'm calling the density of individuals in the field V of TXY, the density of individuals on the road U of TX. Let me give four parameters, as a matter of fact. Mu, the transmission rate between the road and the field. Nu, the transmission rate between the field and the road. And individuals can jump from the field to the road, and they can jump from the road to the field, just as you jump on the bus if the bus passes along you. And small d is the diffusion in the field, and capital D, the diffusion on the road. Okay. You can also say that you have the whole space where you have a road that crosses the whole space, and in fact you can I'll show you what you can write. You can also have other transmission coefficients. So here you would have something like V plus, V minus, U, and you would have transmission coefficients between V plus U, V minus U. So when the whole thing is symmetric, it reduces to what I'm going to present. Okay, beautiful, isn't it? Very simple. So on the road, I'm just having a diffusion equation. DTU minus DUXX is equal to what? Mu U, let's say plus mu U. This is what the road gives to the field. Minus mu V, this is what the field gives to the road. Of course, this has to be totally compensated. So here, there is an exchange condition, which is dvy, or dv nu if you prefer, is equal to mu u minus nu v. So it's the exact compensation of what the road gives to the fields and takes from the field. And inside, we have the Fisher KPP equation, vt minus d Laplace v is equal to alpha u, 1 minus v, sorry, 1 minus v over beta. And I'm going to take beta equals to 1. Beta equal to 1, so that I don't discover it on the slide.
Why do you know reproduction on the road?
Ah, There could be, as a matter of fact. There could be. I could put some reproduction, and as a matter of fact, the result would be one could also analyze. One could also analyze the thing. But actually, what we wanted to we at first didn't want to put reproduction on the road because we wanted to see the effect of the road even without reproduction. And already, it is different. But you can indeed put reproduction on the road, and as a matter of fact, you can also put various other effects. So in any case, at time t equals zero, you put a small density of individuals somewhere in your field, and okay, no one is traveling, and we want to see what happens. So this is something that I proposed some time ago with Henri Berestiki and Luca Rossi, exactly to try to account for. At the time we were not interested in insects. Henri had seen a talk about wolves in Canada following how are they called? I forgot the name, but following some trenches in the roads, and trenches in the forest, and we said that it would be good to try to model this. Okay, so these are the equations. Here they are. So let's see what happens. So first of all, when you look at the equation, the first thing you want to know is what are the steady states. So you put dt equals zero. What are the steady states? So in fact, the only steady states, apart from mu equals zero, nu equals zero, are u star equals to mu, nu over mu, and v star equals to one. So I was very inspired to put beta equals to one, because if this is equal to zero, then you find v is equal to mu over nu. U is equal to nu over mu, and here, if you do everything equal to zero and beta is equal to one, then V is equal to one. These are obvious steady states. To prove that they are the only ones takes a few lines of argument. So this is titled spreading along the road. So the result says that there is on the road an asymptotic spreading speed, which I call C star of D, capital D. So if C is less than C star strictly, then UV goes to U star V star. As much as you not only have U, but you also have V. And this actually transmits slightly inside the field. In other words, here you have U of Tx, here you have V of Txy. And this convergence, this result should be understood pointwise in Y. So in other words, you run with C star of D along the road. If you run a little bit less fast, then your solution converges to U star V star. So U star would be on the road, and V star and V where take any strip. And you have convergence of V to V star, uniformly on this strip. And of course, the result is going to degrade as the width of the strip becomes larger. And of course, if C is larger than C star, then U V goes to zero. So once again, suppose you have hornets. You run on the road. If you run fast enough, you don't see anyone. You don't see one. If you run just a bit too slow, then you're surrounded by hornets. Okay, there are a few things to say about this speed. So one can prove that if the big diffusion is less than 2d, and this is exactly related to Sergei's question, if the big diffusion is less than 2d, then nothing spectacular about the spreading speed on the road. It's just the KPP speed. And CKPP is equal to 2 square root of d alpha. If capital D is strictly larger than 2D, then the speed is strictly larger. And one can prove that, in fact, C star of D over square root of D goes to a finite limit. And as a matter of fact, this is, when you see this effect, this is really the strongest effect you can imagine. It means that the road drives the whole process. It's just as if you had a reaction diffusion equation on the road with a big diffusion. That's the main message. And if you put reproduction on the road, the acceleration is even bigger. So I just want to see how I'm doing with time. Okay, very good, thanks. As you may see, I'm not so used to slides. I prefer the blackboard, but well. Okay, so that's what happens along the road, and let me show you what happens inside the field. So now we're asking what is happening inside the field? What is the spreading inside the field? So here's the result. Turn your head upside down because this picture is due to my colleague Luca Rossi, and he prefers propagation upwards. I prefer downwards. Okay. So this is the road, and upwards this is the field. And essentially, what you look is what happens when you follow one direction. So take one direction in the upper half plane, and you want to understand what the invasion speed is. So in fact, in each direction there is an invasion speed. We can prove this. What is interesting is there are a few interesting things. So here is represented the velocity c star of theta in polar coordinates. So c equals to ckpp. So this dotted curve is the c equals to ckpp in polar coordinates. Okay. The c star meets ckpp above some critical angle. So here he put, I don't know what this Greek letter is, but there is a critical angle for which, if you are above the critical angle, then the invasion speed is less than, is exactly ckpp, sorry. And if you're below this angle, then the speed is larger. As a matter of fact, we submitted this paper to Inventiones and had a friendly rejection. So then we tried CMP and had friendly acceptance. But we were very excited by the fact that there is a subtle effect here. What I wrote is that the Huygens principle is not true in this model. What is the Huygens model? So I'm going to tell you what I know, and then you can tell me that I do not know anything. The Huygens principle for me is the following. So here's the road. The phenomenon is driven by the road. So you run with speed c. And at each time, when the front reaches a point, it emits waves that go at speed ckpp. This is what I call the Huygens principle, which I tested this definition with two physicists, and they seem to accept it. So this is the Huygens principle, and this is what you think is going to be true. And the thing is that it's not true. So this is what is given by the Huygens principle, and this is the actual curve. So in fact, the curve in polar coordinates of the velocity is above the curve given by the Huygens principle.
But it seems that it is due to non-linearity,
yeah? Because yeah, exactly. It's the KPP non-linearity. If you take other non-linearities, then indeed, the Huygens principle is peacefully respected. I agree. It's this seemingly very simple non-linearity that.
But will the same is correct if you replace KPP by stable?
If you replace by stable, then you get this. Yeah. This is what you get. You get the Huygens principle if you solve with the bistable case. Okay, so let me show you an example. Let me show you a numerical validation. So here's a tiger mosquito. So a team at INRA, so INRA is the Institute, National Institute for Agriculture, they actually carried out a study with their models and tried to fit their observed data with the parameters that were needed in the model. So okay, so here's the animal. Okay, here are the stimulations. So here's the map of France, and they put a very elementary network, road network, and so here they simulated the Fisher KPP equation, the pure simple Fisher KPP, and here our road field model. So they wrote the U equation on the roads. Wrote the exchange conditions between the road and the rows and the complement, and they also estimated the parameters given some data about the tiger mosquito. They have actually the data. So you put a small density of animals near Italy. And you see what happens. So Fisher KPP, this Fisher KPP gives you this, and our model gives you something very different. And actually, there are interesting effects. There are interesting non-local effects. Why do they all of a sudden like Brittany? This I don't know. But this is what the simulations look like, and. These are what the observations give to you. So here are real life data. So the mosquito can go everywhere. So they do not peacefully wait for you to introduce them in Italy. They were already somewhere in France. But one can see that indeed, the way they invade the territory is not exactly like the Fisher KPP. Okay, I'm not saying that there's a 10 minus 5 matching between the observations and the simulations, but at least what I like is this part. Because once again, here there is a major motorway system. Here you have Marseille, here you have Lyon, here you have Paris. There's a major transportation system, and the fact that the animal travels along this, at least roughly along this major transportation system is something I think that speaks for the model. Of course, once again, the error is huge, but at least we are doing better than Fisher KPP. And Fisher KPP, as a matter of fact, is a model that is used for simulations, used for actual simulations. Okay, let me tell you about some further mathematical results. So I will first tell you very briefly what some ramifications are. and tell you a little more about the relative free boundary problem and why all of a sudden this pops out. So some ramifications. So we studied various things. So for instance, if you put non-local diffusion on the road, and if you replace the Laplacian by the fractional Laplacian, then you have exponential propagation on the road. And here there's a heat kernel that is not completely trivial to compute. So Anne-Charline Coulomb was extremely efficient at this. We also included transport and mortality on effects on the road. So for instance, individual travel along the road, here you put a mu prime, which is larger than mu here, so the instance can die. You can put effects like CDXU. So I mean, you have transport in a given direction, and the analysis is different and more difficult than previously, but here the analysis is essentially the same. But we get some instances of, we get some interesting effects like if the spreading is very, if the diffusion is very fast, then the animals can actually go counter to the flow. Something more mathematical was the large time dynamics for large D. So now we take the full model. And we look at the Cauchy problem for large D, and we want to look at the profile of the solution. So with Laurent Dietrich, so he was a PhD student of mine, we found new asymptotic traveling wave profiles. Namely, you send the capital D to infinity, you have some specific profiles, and we observed something that we were surprised about, to see that if you look at the Cauchy problem. So take an initial datum, you look at the Cauchy problem, then the solution first, I mean, the spreading occurs for a very long time at bounded speed, and then progressively goes to a speed that is of order square root of d. And of course, we looked at epidemic models driven by roads. So we took the so during the COVID episode, we are all at home, so to occupy ourselves, we took the CR model. I'm not going to say what it is, but essentially we put infective traveling on the road. So I mean, there's not such a difficult way to couple the classical CR model with an equation on the road, and. Once again, our model was not so irrelevant in comparison with the data of northern Italy. And also, we put to light the concept of dormant epidemics. So I guess that everyone knows what is the basic reproduction number. If it's less than one, the epidemics doesn't spread. If it's larger than one, then you're in bad shape. And in fact, there are epidemics, which are called dormant epidemics, where the basic reproduction number is very, very close to one. So you think it's harmless. However, there is a transportation network around with fast diffusion. And so even if the basic reproduction number is very close to one, which would mean that the speed is very slow, then in fact the speed is high. And people think the epidemics is in Toulouse. People in Bordeaux go out in bars, celebrate, drink, and all of a sudden the epidemics hits Bordeaux, and no one knows from where it comes. And this is exactly the concept. Okay, let me finish with. How much time do you have? Okay, good. Okay, so let me finish with something a little more mathematical. So it's a collaboration with Luis Caffarelli. On a related free boundary model. So why free boundaries in this business? I'm going to explain to you. It's due to its numerical simulations. Once again, Anne-Charline Coulomb, she was actually a very strong numericist. And she was working on models with fractional diffusion, and we asked her to see what happens with classical diffusion. So she simulated this model. She simulated exactly this, with alpha beta equal to 1. I mean that's no problem. Mu and nu, no, it's not the matter. Small d, it's not the matter. So she did numerical simulations, and this is. And what you see here are the level sets of the function v. She put a lot of energy in the simulations, and due to the big energy she put in them, she saw something. It's this. This is something we didn't expect. We rather thought that the curve would be something like that. Please note that there's absolutely no contradiction with the speed curve that I showed you, because here the distance between the tip here and the road is bounded in time, whereas what I showed you was a speed curve. So for very large times, if you look at this from very far, this tip gets erased. So why? Okay, let me tell you that at the moment, although I have several heuristics explanations, I'm unable to explain this. So I had two ideas, as a matter of fact. I had two ideas. The first thing was to recall an old approximation I'm going to tell you about in the next slide. An old approximation that transforms a reaction diffusion model, that brings a reaction diffusion model to a free boundary problem. And the other idea was to ask Luis Caffarelli if he was interested. So this led us to the following result. So let me tell you the reductions that we did in order to come to a free boundary problem. So first of all, we look at traveling waves. So TXY is because X plus CTY. Then we also decided that we wanted a more compact model. As a matter of fact, it's not indispensable, but we wanted a more compact model. So you put mu and nu equals to 1 over epsilon, and send epsilon to 0. And so if you have mu over epsilon here, nu, 1 over epsilon here, 1 over epsilon here, at least formally, you get u equals to v. On the other hand, u equals to v, okay, very good. U equals to v on the whole line. On the other hand, mu u minus nu v, whatever the values of mu and nu are, mu minus uv is dvy. So on the road, in the field, you still have your nice equation, and on the road you have minus dvxx plus cvx plus vy equals to 0. Then Luis likes to transform v into 1 minus u. So this is what we did. So for the moment, steps. Okay, this is just looking at the traveling wave. This is just a matter of having a more compact model, and this is just research renaming things. And in fact, the main approximation is to say, okay, let us homotopy this nonlinearity to something like this. So take a very peaked nonlinearity, mass 1, concentrated at 0, and send the beta to plus infinity. So it's actually a well-known approximation in flame propagation theory. Zeldovich was probably the first to realize that it could give good insight in how a flame propagates. And Steve Ashinsky used it a lot to get some very, very interesting formal asymptotics giving many bifurcations. But in any case, flame propagation is not our subject here. The only thing is that I just take a nonlinearity, homotopy it to something that is like a Dirac mass at u equals 0. and see what happens. For the purpose of modeling, this kind of nonlinearity or this kind of nonlinearity, well, I mean, no one can really say that one is better than the other. So, okay, let's live with this. And here's the resulting model. Here's the resulting model. So on the line, we have minus duxx plus cux plus uy equals 0. So it's not so different from this, as a matter of fact. And then we have two phases. We have two phases, a phase where u is positive and a phase where u is negative. We want u to go to 1 uniformly in y. Uniformly is important. Uniformly is important because we are looking at an invasion process. So it means that if you go down inside, then the more down you go, the less individuals you see. So you have to be uniform. You have two phases, and they are separated by a free boundary. One free boundary condition is continuity of the unknown, and the other is the jump in normal. The jump of the normal derivatives is 1. Okay. Inside, this is a very well-known free boundary problem where Caffarelli has, some of the first and most important results about regularity and things like that. And of course, the issue is to understand, if this problem has a solution, and B, what the free boundary does when it hits the line. Okay, so here's the problem. So the result is that if we take the diffusion on the rule larger than 1, I think it's okay for less than 1, but I don't know. But there's an important a priori estimate that fails. The problem has a solution that is probably unique, which is decreasing. The main information is that the gradient is bounded. Of course, inside, that the gradient is bounded is it has been known for 40 years, in 50. It's more delicate. The free boundary is analytic inside. It's not given to you. You have to write half a page. You have to say that, in fact, because dxu is negative, then locally, this problem comes from some energy. And then you get, at least in 2D, you get analyticity. And the free boundary intersects the line y equals 0. Right. How the free boundary hits the line? The reason why I wanted this free boundary is that you can do additional asymptotics, at least formally, if you do some formal asymptotics, you can prove that the free boundary hits the line like an inverted parabola. And in fact, you can prove it. So locally near the line, the free boundary is like an inverted parabola. U of xy is like, it's like 1 like minus x squared over 2d, and you also know the asymptotic profile of U of xy. And as a matter of fact, in three space dimensions, we found some interesting analogies with the obstacle problem. And in fact, the UI plays the role of the membrane, let's say. So that's it. And finally, last thing is that if we look at the free boundary at infinity, the free boundary hits the line like a parabola. Then, okay, there's a region. I drew it like that, but in fact, I do not really know if there are tips. This is something I don't know. But in any case, after some space, the free boundary converges exponentially to a line of angle alpha, and this angle alpha you can compute it, as a matter of fact. And if you have a profile like that, well, you're in a good way to explain the numerics that you've seen so far. So this, of course, is a traveling wave. So what it doesn't explain, what we explain. So if we look at the numerics do something like that, and essentially we explain this part. And to explain this one, we would need to go to the Cauchy problem. Something we cannot do at the moment. Okay. The conclusion is that there is a practical consequence. So suppose you want to control the hornets along the Garonne. Well, it's a good idea to fish for them a little further than the Garonne, because the furthest ones are not the one you think. They are not along the river. They may be a little inside. And that's a practical consequence. So I guess that my time is up. This was my conclusion. So thank you very much. It's actually a theorem. The theorem is the following. There's a very simple expression, and it is due, in fact, to the fact that the free boundary, the dynamical free boundary problem, obeys the Huygens principle. This nonlinearity obeys the Huygens principle. In other words, to compute the angle, just think that locally it's very flat, so it moves with the speed. And suppose that it's 1D, and so it moves with the speed of the wave there's a 1D traveling wave, which is minus 5 seconds plus C phi prime equals delta phi at phi equals 0. With phi at minus infinity is equal to 1. So there's a unique C, as a matter of fact, which is a square root of 2, I think, something like that. That I call C dot. And this has to be C dot. So the angle is this, and the speed is imposed from above. So, because it's imposed from above, the speed here is the same as here. And so, projecting, you find that C is equal to C naught over sinus alpha, which gives you sinus alpha is equal to C naught, the speed of the 1D traveling wave, over the speed of the overall wave. Why, sorry?
In explanation.
Okay. So let me give you two explanations. The first one is that it's going to be a numerical explanation. So write the equation like that, minus uu plus nu v. So Anne-Charline computed this on the road, and she found you run with your solution, and the reaction this is really something like that, and when you it's really something like that, and when you see this, you say, oh, this is a source term. This thing acts as a source term. Another explanation is the following. You have, the overall dynamics is given by the rho. So individuals travel essentially at global speed c. But now, in the vicinity of the road, in the vicinity of the road, they move and reproduce. So the road gives individuals to the field. They can reproduce, and so this projects a few individuals ahead. And this is why I think this is another reason why you have something like that.
Uh-huh. And say diffusion depends on the space, yes?
On the, sorry?
The diffusion depends on the point.
Ah, yeah, okay, of course. Mm.
And you just consider road as a strip.
Yeah, yeah.
This higher diffusion. Mm-hmm. In another case, okay, in that case, kind of, you have to include the multiplication, this term of KPP term in the
Yeah.
But would it be the same model or not?
I think you can. I think you can write this as an asymptotic model of what you said. Maybe you take a strip. You take a thin strip where you.
Should I in that case put diffusion in a
diversion? That's a good question. That's a good question. But once again, you can decide what the diffusion is. I certainly agree to this. I'm not going to tell you what it is, but. I'm sure it can. I'm absolutely sure it can, because these simulations were done by thickening the roads. By make the roads. You see, instead of simulating the equation on roads like that, because they have crossroads, they did something like that. So they wrote equations. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Okay. No, but still, my question is, can it be converted to theorem?
I think so.
Because all that, what
I think so. No. Your question is totally relevant. We didn't do it, but I'm sure it can be converted into a theorem.
Yes. Okay. But is it easy, or you know,
is it easy? Okay. Depends of what you want me to bet. If I'm free to bet,
I feel that this is a hard question.
Okay, I wouldn't say so, but as long as you don't sit in front of a paper and write down things, you don't know. So I would not say my intuition is that it's not so difficult. But as you said, until you have, unless you haven't started writing down things, you can. But I'm sure it can be converted into a theorem, indeed.
One more question. If you change a line of fast diffusion by, for example, two lines forming an angle, or maybe two lines forming a circle, will the same results be true?
Ah, that's another extremely good question. That's also an extremely good question. So what I expect, actually there are results on this. Two lines crossing, I don't think so. But what I expect is that you put individuals somewhere. So I think you are going to have a propagation, asymptotic propagation. If I remember well, it seems that when you go very far from the lines, the memory of the crossing is forgotten, but once again it's KPP. So if it was a bistable nonlinearity, then you have spreading and you have asymptotic spreading, and then in the end you get the Huygens principle, and Okay, here I would, it's not clear to me that the memory of the crossing is forgotten. In other words, things spread very far away, and probably the influence of the initial crossing can be felt. But in principle, but I would say that, okay, you have an asymptotic speed on each road and each direction. This, once again, I can bet. What is the asymptotic speed? I would not bet. But it's a very good question.
Mm-hmm. And a
strip? A strip, then so okay, for KPP. So there are several cases that were actually computed. So you have the case where here you have the road, and here you can say that you have a fence, namely that so you can have. You can have a soft fence, namely that Vy is equal to zero, so no animals can go through. Or you can have a hard fence, you can say V equals zero, so the animals die on the fence. Then essentially, you can compute the speed. It's essentially, it's just as in this model, you linearize around the zero state and look at linear waves and the speed comes out. You can also say that you have two roads. You can say that you have parallel roads. When you have parallel roads, then especially when you have different diffusions, then to compute the speed is an interesting algebraic problem.
Mm-hmm. So, in the theorem of asymptotic speed, yes, for U mm-hmm. and V, mm-hmm. from a line. So, what is the technique to prove it is a suction supersolution?
Yes. I don't have any slides, but I can show you. I can show you. So, in fact, you. So, at least on the road, the principle is to. Okay, so for KPP, so UT minus UXX equals U minus U square. You linearize around zero, so you have VT minus VXX is equal to V, and look at linear waves. Linear waves, namely solutions of the form exponential of lambda X plus CT. Okay, and then you plug this into the equation, and you find that C is larger than 2. Otherwise, you have complex waves. Here, it's the same. The only thing is that the linear waves you plug in are of the form exponential lambda x plus alpha x plus CT. Okay, and here, gamma exponential alpha x plus ct plus beta y. Plug this into the equations, the linearized equation, and you have you can solve. As a matter of fact, it's not so. It's an algebraic system. You would say that it's not so difficult to solve, but in fact, there is a structure that you have to uncover in order to say something. And then when you have the correct c, so it gives you a minimum c. And then so it gives you super solutions, so that gives you the upper speed. And it gives you an upper bound. And to get the lower bound, then it's not so easy. It's also sub solutions, but to construct them is somehow delicate. You have to go to complex waves. So you have to lower C below the critical C. It gives you complex solutions. You have to truncate them, but you have to be careful not to mess with the boundary conditions and also with the boundary condition. And also you have to truncate them in the field. So and with this you can prove things. So the principles is okay. Technical details are surprisingly involved. Okay.
That similarity forces in porous media, the high contrast for permeability, so or you can think diffusion coefficient, but there it's not diffusion coefficient. Then the similar feature of that the the fact that the fastest thing, yes, is not on the
Probably. No,
I don't see any relation inside equations.
No, but, okay, why not?
Did you, have you thought about this? Have you
Sorry?
Have you looked at other phenomena where the similar...
similar things happens? Yeah. Similar things happens? No, not actually. It was the first thing. It was the first we looked at. But then in this vein, so in 3D we looked at configuration like. So here you have minus Laplace. Even you can take minus divergence of A of grad U. Plus UY equals 0, and here we have the free boundary. And what we showed is that in fact this is really a universal phenomenon, and in fact 2D. I mean, 2D plane and 3D space, and essentially on the plane, it's really like an obstacle problem. Like here, you have you can prove that there is a quadratic detachment. You can prove, the solution here grows quadratically. You have the exact analogy with the obstacle problem, and you have C1 alpha. In good cases, you have C1 alpha smoothness of the free boundary, and even more. So.
Okay, then that's thank the speaker again.
Thanks very much.